The intent of this video is to provide those who are right now experiencing extreme weather to get a sense that somewhere the sun is shining, because most certainly it's shining right here. It's a gorgeously calm, perfect evening here in the Bay Area of California. One of my dreams has always been within this dream of existence, this belief system we call existence, to be in a place that is extremely serene and beautiful and calm, and to broadcast from that place to the rest of the world, to give a sense to everybody that somewhere the sun is shining, somewhere it's peaceful, somewhere it's calm, somewhere it's perfect. Okay. I'd also like to tune into a channel, as it were, an inner channel. I wonder if there's an inner channel coming from reality, from paradise, like a broadcast from reality that we can tune into, just like we do, like in a television, you know, click and tune into it and realize that everything is perfect, everything is flawless, everything is absolutely beautiful beyond words in reality. And if we could do that, it would give us a great boost to hang in there, to calm down, to not panic like that. There's two ways to go about it. One is to go about it the way of saying, well, misery loves company. So if I say, you know, I'm in an even worse situation than you, terrible situation, and people say, well, maybe I don't have it so bad. That's one way. The other way is to say, I'm in a perfect situation, and that perfect situation is there for you also. And that gives people real hope. That's the way I'd like to proceed. I'd like to go to a very, very safe, beautiful, calm place and broadcast from there, because I know the turmoil is going to become very severe in this world. Now, as an aside, I have to thank the San Francisco Giants for sweeping the World Series and getting done with it super fast. So now, just in time, I can turn the page. Okay, so let's turn the page and get on with our broadcast now. I don't have to pay any more attention to baseball. And we can pay attention to this storm, which is causing people a lot of concern. Rightfully so. This may be the October surprise. You've heard a lot of people saying it may be an October surprise. Well, this could be it. This could be the October surprise. Surprise means something you don't expect. And I don't know if anyone was expecting this type of storm. I said that in November. Let me bring this volume down just a bit. I said in November, October was the month of momentum, and November will be the month of turmoil. We're seeing the storm come in now on October 29th, 30th, and will continue to rage in the 31st. The turmoil will be felt after the storm passes through and people come out of their caves and look at the infrastructure and all the troubles, and that's when the turmoil is going, oh my gosh, how do we function? What do we do? That's November 1st. So right on cue, the situations are unfolding as it seemed to occur to me that they would unfold. And then, of course, you have the election coming up, which is just, countrywide turmoil, global turmoil, really. And with you add this, superstorm in front of it, causing problems with electricity and all of that, it's really going to just be a tumultuous time. Very bad. So that's why October, it's super important to have gained momentum during the month of October. So going into November, we could then follow these good habits. And I've been trying to instill good habits in myself during the month of October. Kind of succeeding, not perfectly. I'm not out there riding my bike or jogging or yet. I did go out and buy a pair of running shoes today. My other shoes were other running shoes were really old, and the soles were like falling apart and worn through. And I said, you know what? Maybe if I get a new pair of running shoes, I'll start, doing some running, get into that a little bit. Good habits. Once habits are started, it's easy to, you know, you can keep them going. It's not so bad. But when there's turmoil, how do you keep good habits going? How do you start good habits in turmoil? That is the question, right? Which is why I said October, you must prepare good habits. Start a good habit every day. I've kind of been trying to do that as best I can. And have started a lot of good habits, actually, a lot of them. When you're in the midst of the superstorm, how do you start some good habit, you know? How do you do that? You know, you're just like saying, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And you can't start a really good habit. You're not going to start a diet in the middle of, you know, the superstorm, probably. But you can perpetuate habits, a habit that you've already established. You probably can keep that up. So, you know, these warnings that are given out are serious warnings. They weren't just, you know, just to say something for the sake of publicity. I really had this impression, clear impression, that this is very super important. And if you've used October wisely, you'll have some good habits built in. I said, don't wait until the election. Do not wait. And we still have, 9 days before the election. Don't wait. When you wait, it's too late. So what has not yet happened is I haven't transited to any other place where it could be even more beautiful and calm and safe and accepting of these broadcasts. That has not happened yet. I'm still hold out hope that it will, because that it would be a great service to the world. When people are in severe turmoil, what they're looking for is, they're looking and asking and hoping, is there somewhere where things are not like this? That is the key, is it not? And if the answer is yes, absolutely, there's a place where everything is no troubles whatsoever, that gives them hope to continue on. They say, well, maybe someday I can get there too. And they make that their aim. So in a small way, broadcasting videos from a very, very beautiful and serene, safe place gives people a lot of hope. Because it's a metaphor for reality, and a metaphor that, yes, we can escape belief. We absolutely can escape belief by choosing a new idea. The idea that we're choosing now is giving rise to belief. And belief tells us that we have to work within belief for a resolution of whatever we want. It has to be within the context of belief. That is not true. What we need to do is to choose a new idea where belief doesn't arise at all. And that's how we escape belief. So here I can tell you that the about 65 degrees outside, super calm, not even hardly a breath of air, super serene, the crickets are chirping, and gorgeous day. And everything just seems to be very, very calm here. The best service that anyone can do in this world is to choose a new idea. The next best would be to tune into a channel of reality, somehow be aware of reality, and then radiate that assurance out to the world that in reality everything is flawless, it's perfect, there's nothing wrong with reality whatsoever, there's nothing that needs to be fixed, there's no storm that needs to be outrun or hidden from, or protected from, there's no need for protection of any kind because there's no threat of any kind. That assurance can be radiated out of the world. Another way is to broadcast clarification of all this from a very beautiful place where the people see that, hey, somewhere there's something that is really very, very serene. Those are various ways to actually be extremely helpful in the world. You cannot learn to love. That's a contradiction in terms. Love is what is. You can't learn what is. You can only be what is. What is. It's not trying to learn what it is. You can't learn to love belief. Belief is not lovable. Belief is a denial of love. How can you learn to love a denial of love? You cannot. And really, you cannot love bodies. You cannot love body-mind. You cannot love people. You can love truth. And that's what everyone really wants. So as you radiate the assurance of truth that reality cannot be threatened out into the world, that is love. That is what, because that's what people really want. That's what they really love. They really love that which cannot be threatened. And so you're assuring them, yes, it's there for you. It's there for me. It's there for you. It's there for all inclusive, unconditional. That's what love is. Is not trying to establish loving relationships with people, because that's trying to learn how to love belief, and it's impossible. You cannot learn to love. Love is what is reality, and if you're denying what is in reality, you can't learn to love that denial. It's impossible. But so many are believing they need to learn how to be loving people or something. That is not true. That's a contradiction in terms. Loving people is a complete oxymoron, contradiction. It's good news, bad news, or bad news, good news. The bad news is that you can never learn how to love humans. Body, mind, human beings, impossible. The good news is that we're not human. That's the great news. We've never been human. And what we are, which is what is entirely love, lovable. In other words, all-inclusive, unconditional all-inclusiveness, and no threat whatsoever. Complete peace. It's not lovable, it is love. So don't worry if you don't love people or humans or et cetera. You cannot learn to love. It's impossible. That's just belief. Belief tells you can learn how to love. So you say, oh, okay, belief, thank you so much. Just show me how to learn that. And that's belief keeping you within the domain, the kingdom of belief, kingdom of darkness. The kingdom that Jesus said, this is not my kingdom. When they asked, where are you going? He said, why are you leaving us? He said, this is my kingdom. It's the kingdom of darkness. It's the kingdom of belief. It's not a kingdom of all, really. It's nothing. And we cannot learn how to love it. It's impossible. We can't learn to love the denial of love. The denial of love is not lovable, except we can simply allow it. We can accept it as it is. And that does overlay it with love. Okay. But it's within it, it's not lovable. There's no part of it that is lovable. It's when you try and love some of it, some part of it, from within it, it's impossible. But when you overlay it with unconditional love and just accept it as it is, accept the denial of love is simply a denial, an attempt to deny love, that's what it is, then you're experiencing love. You're not experiencing the love of the denial of love, you are simply experiencing love. Love is not the love of something, love of anything, no. It's all that is. It's the total inclusivity of reality. It is reality. It is what is. All of it. It's all one. That is love. It's not subjective. It's not objective. It just is. It is true. So, as you go about your... Hello, cat. The cat's coming to see me. As you go about your day, don't worry about your personality, the body, mind, etc. How it's, whatever it's doing. Just be civil, be kind, compassionate, and however you need to be to get through the day, that's fine. It's not a problem. That's not the issue, not the concern. Belief tries to make it personal. Okay, tries to put you on the hot seat. What's your behavior? What's your attitude? All this kind of stuff. That's all nonsense. It makes no difference to what is whatsoever. What is inherently totally acceptable to reality. Reality is acceptable to itself, completely, without a single exception. So we only need to accept reality as it is, to know this, to experience this. That's it. Just accept reality as it is. And that is to choose the idea of not trying to change reality. In other words, accept it as it is, not trying to be prime creator, which means to change reality. You're not trying to be prime creator, you're not trying to change reality, you're accepting reality as it is, and that is perfect, and you love it. You know, you feel, you know, one with it, included, complete inclusiveness, total inclusiveness. And that's what everyone really wants. We don't really want body-mind relationships. What is that? It's simply relating to vulnerability, to threat, to all that stuff. And belief is telling you that the way to heaven, you have to establish right relationships with everybody. How can you do that? It's not... How can you establish right relationships with impermanence, with threat, with vulnerability, with fear, with denial of love, denial of reality? How can you establish right relationship? That's ridiculous. Reality is not trying to establish right relationship with itself. It's inherently in right relationship with itself. So this whole notion of process, establishing, developing, learning, that's all belief. That's the kingdom of belief. Reject the kingdom of belief entirely. And you might say, well, that's all the teachings in the world. That's all. Yeah, it is. That's right. All the teachings in the world, almost all, are simply the teachings of belief. And you might say, we're supposed to. Of course, belief teaches its teachings in this world. That's all the stuff that I said, no, that's not it, too. When I was young, I said, that's not it. You know, I tried to tell everyone, that's not it. And they said, you know, what do you know? You must not be familiar with this stuff to say it's not it. And now that I'm, you know, familiar with all that stuff, it's still not it. It was not it then. It's not it now. It's not ever going to be it. The teachings of belief will never be it at all. Never have been and never will be. It doesn't matter if a 2-year-old tells you that or a 100-year-old tells you that. It's still exactly the same. It's still not it at all. Now, belief can never understand this, cannot see it. It's amazing how ignorant belief is. What do you want, cat? Probably wants food. That's the only reason the cat is friendly. The cats are always friendly for some reason. They always have an agenda. They're not just coming over and saying, hey, I like you, you're a nice person, you know, let's hang out. No, the cat's saying, you know, I haven't had any food yet, or I want to go inside, or I want to sit where you're sitting, or, you know, something like that. Always an agenda. And belief always has an agenda, too. Hey, cat. Always an agenda. Delay, distraction, misdirection. And it's not easy to get out of belief, simply because the entire world is just the teachings of belief. It's just a belief system. And you don't get much encouragement here to go beyond belief. What most... Hey, cat. Wanted to get in the picture there. What most do is they try to reach the highest place within belief. And dwell there in some relatively high place relative to other aspects of belief. But the truth is, in belief, it's all the same. It's all nothing. And the so-called high, dwelling in the high places of belief is temporary, and you find yourself cycling down through other places that you don't want to be in, and you feel like you're in simply in this vast current that is simply moving you against your will, and you feel powerless and helpless and hopeless within this vast current of belief. Like there, you just and you just hope and pray that you're going to be moved to some place you want, but it doesn't really work out that way most of the time. And then you wonder, you know, what's in charge of this life, or what's in charge of my experiencing? I feel like I'm not in charge of it. Well, it's belief that's in charge of it. Because we want belief to be true, we accept the dynamic of belief and engage with it. And by engaging with it, it's as if, hypothetically, as if we were experiencing all this stuff in belief. Hey, and it's terrible. It's really terrible, because you feel like there's some power that is simply pushing you, or dragging you along, and you don't really want to go here or there or do that, and still you're dragged along. And sometimes you get, storms, you get in the middle of turmoil and chaos and all this stuff, and you say, I don't really want to be here, and yet belief, your protestations fall on deaf ears, really, with belief, because belief believes it has the answer for you. And it doesn't really care about the means at all. It believes that by getting you to the end, all will be forgiven. So it doesn't really, it has no compassion, and it doesn't care about your suffering at all. Belief does not care about it, not really. It's very pious about it, of course, and it pretends to care so much, but it doesn't care at all. What it says is, whatever suffering you're going through is justified, because it will help you reach the end. And when you reach the end, the goal, which is to find a way to threaten reality, then we'll be able to force the Prime Creator to change reality, and we'll be made Prime Creator. At that point, all will be forgiven, because we got what we wanted. So, hey, stop that. He's now starting to bite into the cord, because he knows I don't like that. It's like a storm, right? A storm comes in and starts to bite you, right? Trying to get your attention. The storm wants something from you. It's hungry for what? What is a storm hungry for? Destructivity, right? Turmoil. It's hungry for trauma. And this storm comes in, it is hungry for trauma. And it's going to knock down your power lines. Let me get this cord out of his way. And it's going to, shut off your power. It's going to cause your, refrigerator, the food, to everything to melt in there and go bad. It's going to cause you to, cold. It's going to cause you a lot of stress and trauma and fear and all that stuff. That's what the storms are aiming for, of course. Death and destruction, trauma, basically. Storm is after that, and it will knock down all those trees and knock down all those power lines and do its dance of destruction. That's what it's for. Flooding, all sorts of flooding, misery brings misery, trauma and misery, and then it goes on its way. And does it care about you? No, it does not. Does nature care about us? No, it does not. Does nature care about what it does to itself ceaselessly? No, it does not. Belief only cares about reaching the end. And how it reaches the end, belief doesn't matter to belief one bit. It doesn't even have the tiniest bit of real compassion at all. It is fanatically driven, fearfully driven to reach the goal, reach the end point, which is to develop some kind of super weapon that can threaten reality, some power to threaten reality and with destruction. And so these storms come in, they're just working on this trauma, this destructivity. And the storms are actually getting more and more ferocious in the world, aren't they? Have you noticed that? What was it, last year there was like the super snowstorm through Chicago and the Midwest. and then we had the derecho in Washington, D.C., that super windstorm knocked out power. Then we had the super drought, terrible drought in through Midwest, much of a lot of the country. It just goes on and on and on. Last year there was Irene, which wreaked a lot of havoc. And then we had that, what was that one down in the Gulf shores, the Gulf Coast this year? There was that hurricane in the Gulf, which, you know, brought a tremendous amount of flooding. Now we have the ones called Sandy coming up through the eastern seaboard and the northeast and large areas of the country. More and more trauma, more and more traumatic stuff is happening in the world. And that's by design. That's the way belief works. Belief is a generator of trauma. But consider this, trauma is best generated when you have a situation where people are not expecting the trauma, where they seem to be living kind of a good life, and then suddenly the good life gets snatched away from them. You know, something, boom, traumatic happens, and it's like just, you know, severe, severe trauma, which is why people are afraid of something, of good times, good situations. They're afraid of those things because what they're afraid of is going to be a trick. That's a trick of belief, and that belief is setting you up, which most times it is setting you up, which is why people are afraid of good fortune. They say, no, I don't want a good fortune. I don't want to be set up. I don't want to be put on a pedestal to be knocked down. And you notice in the world how people, they're people who put others on pedestals. You know, why? So then they can tear them down again. That's how it all works. That's how belief works. However, the grace of God can also put you in a very fortunate situation, and in that situation, it's not to snatch it away from you, and cause trauma. It's to show that there is this stability. It's to give a reflection of reality, as it were. And so, you know, we have to. It's not an easy thing. I'll tell you that. It's not easy to know, you know, what is the grace of God and what is simply the universe giving you, belief giving you something, so it can take it away from you. That is the question. Boy, I know some situations that are amazing situations. I can't speak directly to them because to protect the anonymity of the people. But you have situations where people have their dream situation presented to them that they've worked their whole life in. And then something totally out of left field comes into play and just wrecks everything for them. And they lose their life's work. And it's just, you know, you can hardly believe it. You couldn't write a movie hardly like that. It's so perfectly scripted to be a super traumatic thing. You just say, wow, that can't possibly be a coincidence. It's just the way it's working is like, it's definitely scripted. Everything is scripted here. Belief scripts everything. It plans everything. It sets everything up like a movie set. You know, your belief is like a movie producer. The producer gathers all the different, you know, subcontractors of the movie in the specialties, and they set up everything just right. They build a set like a disaster movie. They build a model set, basically. You know, skate to scale in this big sound stage, and they have all these lighting and cameras around it, and then they start destroying the set, and they're, you know, high speed filming of the set, and then they're able to make it look as if this real actual city, you know, is being completely destroyed. But they set it all up very meticulously ahead of time. Every last little thing is thought of how to carry out this shot and capture it on film and then present it to the world. And belief is like that. That's how belief works. Belief very meticulously sets everything up, puts everything in place, and then, you know, a camera, lights, camera, action. like that, okay? And boom, 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 all the squibs, you know, the explosions, boom, pop, 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 over here. And, you know, this collapses, that collapses here, this tilts, you know, in comes the water, you know, the fire's over here, and boom, 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 and they're filming it, and they may do it in sequences. Here in California, you know, growing up in California, we, you know, are supposed to know how the movie industry works. And so my dad was part of the movie industry for a while. It's one of the studios down in Hollywood when he was younger. And, you know, you grow up with an understanding of the whole deal of how movies are produced. But the fact is that this is how existence is also produced. And that's just a very crude example of the sophisticated production of existence by belief. Belief is the producer of existence, and it's a disaster movie, really. It's a horror movie, and the good times are just being set up for trauma, you know. You have this ideal bucolic countryside, you know, and there's pastoral scenes of people strolling, you know, and they're just they're like a dreamland. It's so nice, the rivers and the creeks and little streams and the beautiful cottages and everything seems so nice, you know, and great. You know, maybe it's like, you know, everybody is kind of like, you know, This is pretty cool. We're in kind of a pretty cool situation. Then, potato blight comes, you know, and destroys all the potato crop, like Northern Ireland. Some of my ancestors came to America from fleeing the potato famine, and everybody's just starving to death. I mean, you go from, you know, jolly, everybody's getting along, kind of jolly, and this is, you know, this is pretty cool living here on this planet. You know, everything's you know, it's not easy, but, you know, we have our enjoyments, and life's not so bad. And then suddenly, one, you know, day, the some blight on the potatoes, and gets into them, and gets worse and worse and worse. Before you know it, the potato crop is ruined, and there's no more food. And people are absolutely starving to death. And there you go. Okay. Just one little example. You can take any example from history like that. And you have people living their life thinking like things are pretty good. And then some war just comes sweeping through. You know, some really catastrophic situation comes along. You know, you're living in Leningrad or something, you know, those various places in Russia, and that beautiful city, and you're, you know, going along, and wow, the city life, we got great culture, you know, there, and this is pretty good. And then World War II breaks out, and the city's under siege, and everything's cut off, and all the supplies and the food, and you're eating rats, and you're dying, and getting susceptible to all sorts of illnesses, and it turns into this ghastly nightmare. You know, you're being shelled constantly, everybody's dying. I mean, you can't really make movies that can really depict just how absolutely horrible existence is when trauma, you know, springs upon it. You could go back, you know, all throughout history. I could do it endlessly, tell you about all the endless stuff throughout history, you know, the absolute barbaric, you know, trauma that is, you know, inflicted upon people who just seem to be living, you know, a very pretty nice life, and life is good, you know. They have their kids, they have their grandkids, you know, and people are getting married, they're having feasts, and they're feeling, you know, warm to other people, affectionate, and like, this is pretty cool. And then from the steppes, you know, of Central Asia come the Golden Horde, you know, sweeping over the steppe and sweeping down into these cities and villages and places, and just laying absolute waste and slaughtering everyone and burning all the villages and just laying waste to the countryside and food and everything, and just raising it to the ground, and, you know, and carrying off, you know, all the maidens, you know, with them, and just this, you know, unbelievable, shocking, traumatic stuff. That is exactly what has happened in history. What happens is everybody gets lulled into a false sense of security time and time and time and time again. That's exactly what happens in this world. You get lulled into a false sense of security. You build up all this, you know, hedonistic, pleasurable, wonderful, beautiful civilization and situation that you think, you know, life is good. Finally, life is good. And then kaboom, drama comes along because you've been set up. The whole thing is a setup entirely. They say, what do they say? The price of freedom is eternal vigilance. Meaning, you know, if you don't want to get, you know, traumatized, for example, like in the South, in Dixie, in the United States, you know, what do they call it? Antebellum, but before the war, antebellum South. I mean, for the people of means there, you know, the civilization there, other than, of course, the slaves, well, the situation was terrible for them. Which is, again, they were traumatized there in Africa. Some, you know, slave traders come, the agents, they, you know, capture. You may be living in a nice, beautiful village and smiling and loving everyone, and then suddenly they're raid on the village and everybody's dragged away in chains and shipped off to all different places in the world. And you find yourself, some of them found themselves down in the South, and then but the ones that, you know, were the management class of the South and the middle class and all those, were living a pretty nice life, really. I mean, you know, life in the antebellum South was, you know, they got lulled into a very false sense of security then, right? And then, you know, boom, Civil War broke out and it turned into a horrendous nightmare, and then you had Sherman, you know, going through what, Georgia and Atlanta and all that, you know, raising everything, just utter destruction, worse than any hurricane, you know. So, you know, that happened very quick, and before that, you know, oh my gosh, people were sipping mint juleps on their patios and, you know, listening to, you know, chamber music and dressing in fine clothes and dining, you know, wonderfully. And just living the life of Riley, you know. And just a little bit later, the South was, you know, absolutely devastated. Yeah. You can come up with example after example after example and never run out of examples, really. And is this all just coincidence, you know? It's just not just luck. It's like saying the Giants won the World Series just because they were lucky or something. Well, they won two out of the last three World Series just because they're lucky. No, it's not because they're lucky. It's because it's the residue of the luck is the residue of design, and they're really good at what they do. They have a plan with what they do. Pitching, defense, speed, and enough hitting to back all that up, and super good fundamental organization is super strong and good. All that enables them to prevail. And so belief, all this trauma is not just luck. It's not bad luck. It's designed. Belief, that is how belief, that's how it rolls. Okay, that's how it works. It's constantly setting us up, lulling us into complacency, and then boom, taking everything away from us, you know. People that you know, floods and tornadoes, you're in a beautiful Midwestern town, you know, just like life is great. You're fishing, you're hunting, you're going to sporting contests, you're eating very well, you've got a lot of friends, you have a good job, and you know everybody, everything is just, you know, it's you're living a good life, and then a tornado comes along one day, poof, flattens the entire place, devastates things, a lot of people die, you know, you're just like, wow. Or you're a farmer and you know, you're just, my gosh, you're rolling in money, you have all these crops and everything, life is great, and then the drought comes, devastates you. On and on and on and on and on. That is the way that belief rolls. It keeps rolling along that way, lulling you into this false sense of complacency. On the other hand, the grace of God can put you in a place where you're not traumatized, a very, very good place, which is free from all that kind of stuff, because you're willing to gravitate away from belief. Okay, and so the more you gravitate away from the belief, the less traumatic dynamic belief can bring upon you. But this is a somewhat tricky subject because, again, deep within us, we kind of don't trust it. We say, "Oh boy, like somebody, gives you like a brand new, Corvette." And here you go. Here's the keys, brand new and free. Wow. And you think, "Wow, this is great." And you drive along, suddenly you start getting, "Uh-oh, am I being set up? Am I being set up?" We all have that feeling, right? Get this feeling, like intuition, like, "I think I feel like I'm being set up here." And next thing you know it, boom, you crash the Corvette, and you're in the hospital. These assisted living homes are not just full of old people waiting to die. There's a lot of those, but there's also young people, middle-aged people, people of all age groups that have had terrible, trauma inflicted upon them. And it's really, my gosh, it's very sobering. When I saw someone who was a CEO, high-tech company, had all these great cars, and money and homes. I mean, he just was like on top of the world, and got in a car accident. And was just rendered like a vegetable, just horrible. And so this is existence. This is belief. This is what everybody here is worshiping, trying to get on its good side. It doesn't have a good side, but we're all trying to find a way to get on its good side. It doesn't have a good side. It's only got a tre It's only tr treacherous. Existence is treacherous, absolutely treacherous. This belief system is treacherous. It's trying to find a way to be completely treacherous to reality. In other words, to be able to destroy reality. And it's trying to find a way, by hook or by crook, to accomplish this. Trying to figure out a way, and it just uses these body minds as cannon fodder for this, laboratory rats for this effort. We're just laboratory rats, is all we are to belief. And of course, belief will pump us up and think we're special. It's just, again, lulling us to sleep so then it can pounce on us again. And yet people go back again and again and keep embracing belief. And belief keeps pumping out all these teachings, constantly come pumping out teachings. And people continually, accept those teachings as true. And all those teachings do is to set you up for another fall. Literally, all the belief does is set you up for a fall. As it's raising you up, it's simply setting you up for a fall. That's it. Nothing else other than that. And the better you see this, you say, there must be, is there anything beyond belief? Of course there is. Reality is beyond belief. Belief is a denial of reality. It's attempt to it springs from the desire to deny reality, which means to deny what is as it is and try to change it. And it has no effect on reality whatsoever. So reality is still completely the way that it's always been. And we can get escape belief simply by choosing a different causal agent. The causal agent we're choosing now is the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That's the causal agent. That idea cannot be experienced right now. It cannot be experienced. All experience is now in reality, but it cannot be experienced now because it's impossible. It's futile. Reality can't be changed. So we have a desire to experience it, not now, but later. We're reaching for the experience. We're moving into it. We're growing into the experience or something. As a desire, and that does the desire that this become true, that we can change reality, the desire that it can become true, not be, but become true, gives rise to what's called belief. And belief then presents how it can become true. And then belief is then presenting all the scenario to spirit, and spirit is simply wanting it to be true, watching it, paying attention to it, fixated on it, wanting it to be true. It's like watching a World Series game. You want one team to win. You want it to win. You want it to win. You're watching it go, "Come on, I want you to win. I want you to win." But belief is not like the Giants. Belief can never win. It's a game it cannot win. It cannot reach the goal to change reality and make a spirit prime creator. can never do it. So we watch in vain. It's all in vain what we're doing. And belief simply has no choice but to present a way, a plausible way, that this can be accomplished. And the only plausible way is to force the prime creator to change reality. It's the only plausible way. There is no way, but therefore we have to settle for a plausible way. And the only plausible way is to force the prime creator into changing reality. And the only way to force the prime creator, only plausible way, is to threaten reality with destruction. Because we know the prime creator, you know, loves reality. And if we can make the prime creator fear the loss of reality, then we plausibly believe that prime creator has no choice but to change reality and make us prime creator. But the truth is, the prime creator cannot change reality. Cannot. It's immutable from the very beginning. Nothing. There's no way to change reality at all. It was perfect, flawless, immutable, unchangeable from the very beginning. So if you ask, is there anything impossible for the prime creator? Yes. The prime creator cannot change reality. The prime creator cannot destroy itself, cannot attack itself, cannot threaten itself, cannot get rid of itself, cannot change itself, cannot do any of that to reality, cannot do that. Absolutely impossible. So we're barking up the wrong tree in attempting this whole idea, to experience this idea. It cannot be experienced. But we empower belief because we want it to work. That's the only reason. We want it to work. So we're engaged. We engage with belief. And we engage with its song and dance. And we continue to engage and because we say, yeah, we're almost there. When belief tells us we're almost there. Belief just lies to us constantly. That's all it can do is lie. As Jesus said, is a liar and deceiver and murderer from the very beginning. From the very beginning. And that's all that it is. And yet we're willing to, you know, accept these lies as, you know, that we're making progress. We're accepting belief, saying it's making progress. Progress is being made. This is going to work. This is going to work. And we say, okay. Keep going. I want to keep going with this. And then we keep set up, lulled into complacency. And then trauma, you know, so strikes the body, mind down. Accumulate all of that data as if it were some kind of force that we're accumulating, some kind of power that a super weapon can focus on reality at some point. Some kind of laser beam of trauma, you know, of loss, of death on reality, as if that we can, you know, somehow threaten reality. Cannot be threatened. So all this arises from our idea that we want to entertain, wanting to be prime creator. We're just entertaining an idea. All of this simply comes from entertaining an idea. That's it. That simple. And all we have to do to get free of belief is entertain another idea, a different idea. That's it. And another idea, what would that be? Simply the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not wanting to be prime creator. That's it. That simple. You know, just a very clear remedy, you know, the opposite. Say, now, I don't want to be prime creator. I want to accept reality as it is. And that can be experienced right now. There's no desire. It can be immediately experienced right now. No desire, and therefore no belief needed to tell us that it's going to happen at some point. No, it's experienced right now without any gap whatsoever. Unconditional love overlay, the overlay of all everything that ever rose in belief is overlaid perfectly. So we can do that. Everyone can do that easily. Doesn't require any effort, anything special. No specialness, you know. It's simply any one of us. All we have to do is exchange ideas that we're entertaining. Instead of entertaining this one, we now entertain this one. We just choose, just a choice. Of course, the choice is coming from spirit. Belief doesn't recognize that choice. Belief believes that all choice happens within belief. So what belief tells us is we have to believe something else. And therein lies the problem. That just strengthens belief, doesn't it? That just strengthens belief. It just strengthens belief. By believing in something else, like I believe in enlightenment, I believe in this, believe in that, it just makes things worse. It doesn't matter what we believe in, it makes no difference. It's that we simply accept the facts that don't need any belief in them, and accept the fact that we simply, all we have to do is make a simple choice, exchange ideas. Make the exchange of ideas, and now you have the idea of not trying to change reality, and so not needing any way to force reality to be changed, not needing any process to develop some threat to reality, not needing belief at all. No need for belief. We always, you know, fall for the notion that we need to believe in something different. No. Don't. We need to choose something different. Choosing is not belief. We're not believing. We keep trying to believe we can do it. I believe I can do it. But that just leads us astray. We just have to do it. We just have to choose. And we don't do it because we keep trying to believe. We think we believe that believing does it. Let's believe in another idea. I believe in another idea. That's not the same as choosing a new idea, right? Because in choosing a new idea, there isn't any belief arises from that. No belief at all. And belief says, well, that will cause the, if you know, belief to be wiped out. If we believe in another idea, then isn't that other idea dependent on the belief? Right? So it just fosters greater dependency on belief when we say, I want to believe in another idea. Now we have to get to choosing another idea. It's not dependent on belief. It's dependent on reality at that point. Because reality will automatically give rise to the effects of that idea. Effortlessly. So It's a rare thing that choice is exercised in this universe. Rare thing. Almost everything is always believing in, choosing to believe in something, or believe in this, or believe in that. Just belief choosing what to believe in. That is not the answer. That is not what we're going for. We're going to choose a new idea where belief doesn't even arise at all. Now, we might do this, and there might be some delayed effect. The effect may be delayed somewhat in some way. If we're actually experiencing it in our awareness, where we believe we're at right now, it's possible, yeah. I have heard that some say you're enlightened, and yet it has not yet sunk in. Case in point, the Giants just won the World Series, 4-game sweep, and for me, it hasn't sunk in yet. I haven't really quite registered it yet, really. It's like I'm still saying, did that really happen? Was that some kind of dream? How did it happen? You know, but really? It hasn't sunk in yet. It has not, because it was like so improbable. So you know, you can actually choose a new idea and you may have not accepted the results of that choice yet. You may be thinking, I couldn't have possibly done that. Did I really do that? And it may somehow delay the effects from showing up here. That's very possible. I don't know how long it's going to take to sink in. It's like, was that some kind of dream? It feels like a dream, really. It just didn't seem plausible at all. It's really, really amazing. And so it's possible we can choose a new idea, and we may not be willing to accept the effects of that right off the bat. I might have already done that. It's possible I already did that. And it's just taking a while to get to the point of accepting the effects of it. Now, what Jesus tells us in A Course in Miracles is that we actually, all of us have actually already chosen a new idea. And actually we did it, boom, like that, because it didn't take any time at all, really. But that the acceptance that we chose a new idea has been delayed. We're not willing to accept this fact. We're in denial of the fact that we've already chosen a new idea. That's what Jesus says. So it could be that all of us have already done this, and that we're simply unwilling to, we're willing to choose a new idea, but we're not willing to accept the effects of it. So, you know, belief is really lost its hold on us, really fundamentally, but practically we keep engaging the memory of belief. Jesus tells us we're actually going on a memory of belief. It's only a memory. It's not really here at all anymore. But we're going on a memory of belief to avoid accepting the effects of choosing a new idea. So this kind of teaching, these types of satsangs here, Christ Clarity Satsang, is to basically help melt the ice, you know, to accepting the effects of choosing a new idea. So from the highest theory, it is, if you accept what Jesus says, all of us have already chosen a new idea. It's already been done. Long, long, long ago. And we're just living with the memory. We choose to dwell in the memories of belief, how belief, you know, works to deny us the effects. It's denying us the effects, as it were, seems to be interfering with our acceptance of it, because we want it to be so, but it's actually just a memory of belief. So any breakthrough would be simply mean to allow the effects of the idea of not trying to be prime creator, allow them to manifest here, like that. It's like that you've got an MP3 player, and it's playing this music. It's playing it, right? But let's say you haven't plugged the headphones in, okay? And you're refusing to plug the headphones in. Instead, screaming in terror or something. And someone says to you, hey, you know, why are you screaming in terror? He says, because there's nothing else. And they say, well, why don't, on this MP3 player, there's this incredibly beautiful music. And you say, what good is that for me? And you say, well, if you just plug your headphones into it, you'll hear it. And we say, huh, really? And we start thinking, considering that. Maybe I should plug my headphones in. Right? So that is really the situation in the world. The beautiful music of reality is already playing for us. We just need to plug our headphones into it and hear it, experience it, allow the effects to be experienced. But our desire for memories to keep playing causes all this drama and stuff, really. Memories of belief. We keep wanting to play that out, keep playing those memories, and so it keeps playing out, the trauma keeps playing out, as if it were still, you know, actually coming from an idea that we were choosing, whereas actually we've already chosen a new idea. That's what Jesus says in A Course in Miracles, and that could very well be correct. I don't know for sure if that's correct, but it's certainly worth considering. And just like everything in these videos, it's simply for your consideration. You know, if you hear something worth considering, then, you know, consider it. That's all. I tried to bring up that which is worth considering, passing on the various, what I've come across that is, I find worth considering. I pass that on, and then if insights come, I pass those on and say, hey, you know, this may be worth considering. And if you don't feel it's worth considering, then fine. Just, you know, pass it by for now. Maybe later at some point, just, you might, you know, believe it's worth considering. I don't know. But it could very well be that all we have to do is say, okay, I'll accept the effects, because I'll accept the fact that I already chose a new idea, that I did it, you know. Why not? What's it gonna harm, you know? So we all hope we get to that point. I've always hoped I'll get to that point, you know, where I just say, okay, I'll accept the effects of it. Why not? And we can do that. We absolutely can do that. Everyone else can do that. And the more that do that, the easier it probably gets for others to see, it's safe to accept those effects. It's a safe thing to do. Now, sometimes, you know, various teachers and gurus seem to act in sort of strange ways that kind of like freak us out. But I would say that generally, that they're functioning within a culture and a tradition, and the stuff they do within that culture and tradition, it isn't strange to those who are accustomed to that stuff. But to those who are coming from a different culture and tradition, it might seem very weird indeed. And then there are some faux gurus, etc., who are just really weird. Yeah, you know, it's not because of culture tradition. They're just operating from belief. But the others, who the genuine ones, they might seem a little odd, you know. I remember someone asking me, you know, about Ramana Maharshi saying, why in the world is that man walking around in just a loincloth, you know, almost naked? Like, what in the world is going on? You know, that's really weird, you know. I said, yeah, I mean, for our culture tradition, you know, you don't see that at all. And it would be really strange and weird, but not in India. Not at all. It's very completely normal, completely acceptable. So don't get freaked out over what anyone particular ambassador of reality in this world happens to act in a particular way. If it's, you know, in a very different culture, different time, different place, different culture, different traditions, different expectations, all this kind of stuff. You just, you know, don't worry about that. Because people from that tradition may look at us and say, wow, those people are like completely weird, you know. why would they be watching baseball or something? That's crazy. Something, I don't know. It's just a pastime. Kind of a social pastime, basically. So just get to the heart of the situation, and don't worry about all the cultural differentiations throughout history. Because really, if you look at that stuff, it's like, wow, completely, so it's just like really out there, really strange. And of course, the kind of teachings that come up can, you know, as far as social teachings and economic teachings, all this kind of stuff can seem very strange. You know, the idea that you just, you know, some people just, like the father of Ananda Maima, just, he abandoned the family. He would abandon the family for years at a time, I believe. Nobody even knew where he went. And what he'd do, he'd take his musical instruments and just start, you know, playing and singing and just wander off. He just wandered off into the boondocks, singing the religious, chanting religious Sankirtan and religious songs, and He had a great voice, and he'd just go to village, and he'd just disappear and just wander throughout Bengal, and who knows where. I don't think he ever really said where, or didn't really care where. You know, he didn't have food, he didn't have clothing, he didn't have anything. He just took off. And back to that time, there was no problem. People just, you know, say, oh, okay, no problem. You know, for us, you know, they'd have an Amber Alert out or something, you know, or the equivalent of an adult Amber Alert out, right? And the whole country would be seeking for this person and to return him back to the family and the job and everything and get him on meds immediately. But back then, it was no big deal. The relatives would help out, and everybody would, you know, just deal with it. And they actually thought it was a blessing from God, because to do that was a sign of holiness, you know. And then one day he'd just simply show up back home, you know. And that's how it went. But we would view that as like, whoa, you know. Yeah, are you kidding? Who could do that? I mean, how can you, at this day and age here, you know, wander off in a loincloth, beating a drum, chanting, you know? I mean, maybe you could go to Berkeley or something and do that. But it still wouldn't be any fun whatsoever, because you'd probably get mugged. Back then, you didn't get mugged, you know? No, people took care of you. Where did you eat? Where did you stay? Villagers' homes. If you were a bard, you know, a ball or a singer of holy songs, etc., wandering about the countryside. I think they called what the balls, who tradition in Bengal of itinerant singers who simply wandered the countryside singing. You would be taken in, you would be fed, you would be given shelter, you know, whatever you need, and then you'd wander on to the next place. It was a very strong tradition there. But of course here, you know, you need an identity, you know. If you don't have an identity, how can you function at all? And how can you get food unless you go dumpster diving? And, you know, it's an entirely different situation. Back then you could get transportation in lots of different ways. People would, you know, give you some form of transport here. Here, you know, can you get on a bus without money, without a ticket, a taxi, a car, a train, a plane? You know, used to be people hitchhike in the 60s, my gosh. I remember we were on the route to Big Sur and going through town, and there was just a constant stream of hippies hitchhiking through town on the western west coast hippie trail, you know, coming from various places. They'd come into San Francisco and Berkeley and Oakland, and then they would hitchhike down through Santa Cruz, down the coast, down to Big Sur, and then continue on down to Los Angeles and kind of looping around and various places down there. And it was just a constant, you know, flow. It was unbelievable. People with backpacks, you know, they'd carry backpacks and everything, you know, their sleeping bags and their ponchos and a little tin plate. They were like modern day balls kind of thing. Back in the 60s, it's gotten a lot tougher these days to do that. They outlawed hitchhiking because of all the traumas that people were experiencing. And, you know, it got, back in those days, you know, it was pretty safe to hitchhike, actually. Back in those days, we didn't even lock our cars. Nobody locked their cars. Most people just left their keys in the car. And nobody, you know, windows rolled down. Leave all your possessions in the car. You never gave it even a first thought. Like, hey, I need to lock my car. What is that? Never even occurred to lock your car, you know, and where we were. And now people, you know, but eventually, you know, the scene got, you know, got darker and darker and darker. But originally, initially, you could hitchhike across the country. People are hitchhiking across the country all the time. Jack Kerouac on the road, talking about driving around across the country, and people, you know, hitchhiking, picking up people. That was very, very common. The beatniks traveling back from Greenwich Village in New York, you know, to the North Beach in San Francisco, and just common as can be. And if you saw somebody, you know, needing a ride, stop. Hey, we got room in the station wagon. Hop on in. Where are you going? Okay, we'll take you so-and-so. And you stop, you drop them off. It's transportation. It was transportation for people who didn't, you know, didn't have any money, didn't have a job. They were seeking. They were seekers. They were seekers of, what were they seekers of, is the question. They couldn't define it. They didn't know what they were seeking for. But it was something within, that, like Paradise Lost. They were seeking for Paradise Lost, really. And they thought they got the essence. They thought they had, you know, had found it. And they do their body work, you know, in the hot tubs of Esalen, overlooking, you know, the Pacific Ocean, and you know the incredible, you know, beauty situation there. And you know, and when they didn't quite find Paradise Lost, they'd start taking drugs, you know, to try and tune into it. They couldn't find the channel. They thought the drugs helped them tune into the channel. You know, where is that channel? I can't tune into it. Don't have the, can't find the right attunement to it. They're trying to attune to something. On the Road, Canned Heat, On the Road Again. You know that song. You can Google it, On the Road Again. Da 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 da. It's great. That was a song. Da 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 da. On the Road Again. People, Woodstock Nation. You know, moving. Everyone was searching, seeking something. You know, but here at the end of the trail, you know, we go down, you know, we go down Big Sur all the time, just, you know, just as family trip or something. There's nothing there for us. It's like we live here. And so, you know, we know this isn't paradise. You know, got all sorts of problems here. It's terrible. But the people from, coming from the mean streets of, you know, Detroit or something, not to put Detroit down, because they don't, I'm sure they're not feeling so good after getting swept. But they come from some, you know, hard scrabble place. Yeah, brutal winters, you know. They come out here to California, it's December. You know, mamas and papas were, you know, California dreaming. You know, they came here from some wretched, you know, wretched place. By way of the Caribbean. And they come out to, you know, Laguna Beach or Southern California. It's the middle of December, and it's like, you know, 82 degrees or something. And it's just like unbelievable. You know, and it's just like they think they found paradise. But if you grow up here, you know this is not paradise. You see, you've got a leg up on everyone else because you don't waste all that time seeking. You say, hey, you realize everybody else is coming here to find paradise. And you know, this place is terrible. What are you talking about? It's not paradise. See, you already know that. So you can get serious. You get more serious here because you can tend to not spend time seeking. Because if you're already in the place that everyone's seeking for, then you already know what it's like. And you can say, well, if this is like, if everyone has been seeking everywhere in the world and they're coming here and they say, this is the best place in the world, you know, and you're already there and you know it's terrible, then you're not going to waste your time seeking anywhere else in the world. And you're going to get down to business. You can get down to business. Which is what I did, basically locked myself in a room for like about, you know, 10 years and studied A Course in Miracles 14 hours a day. And I said, hey, you know, no more wasting time. Get down to business here, you know. I'm not going to spend my time hitchhiking around the country looking for something because I'm already living in, you know, the best place in the world. And all the problems here are just as bad as anywhere else, really. All the inner problems, all the egoic problems, the problems of belief, exactly the same as anywhere else, any place in history, all the same. Terrible stuff. All the games that the belief plays are all totally in play here. Totally in play. And then, of course, we think we have a nice, beautiful little sleepy little town, and next thing you know, somebody invents the silicon chip, and somebody figures out a way to build a home computer, and next thing you know, all the geeks in the world are descending on this place, and everybody comes fabulously wealthy, and the place is completely unrecognizable now. And then you talk about drama, you know, having your sleepy little town transformed into, like, you know, the epicenter of nouveau riche. You know, it's like insane. You know, it's like totally traumatic. Who are these people? You know, it's like the barbarians, you know, completely descended here. And, you know, they, you know, built Silicon Valley. It used to be nothing but orchards, fruit orchards. And then, of course, all the, you know, aerospace industry, like Lockheed, came in here. The defense contractors started coming in here, and all the engineers and all that kind of stuff. And IBM came in, and all these, you know, SRI, Stanford Research Institute, you know, attracted a lot of capitalized, a lot of venture capital came in here and started building up this whole Silicon Valley thing. And then eventually, you know, all these inventions occurred here and brought in all these brainiacs from all over the planet to here, and who are supposedly, you know, said, don't worry, we've got the answer, we've got what you're seeking for. And now, of course, living through all of that, the epicenter of all of that, you know, that's not what we're seeking for. That's not what we really want at all. And realizing that early on, again, helped me get down to business. Saying, hey, you know, I see exactly what's happening. I mean, we started out with the first, you know, Apple computers, you know, basically from almost from ground step one, you know. It's like in our backyard, and you get the Apple, the two, whatever, two something, I or C or whatever, and you get these, you know, first rudimentary ones, and you get better and better and better, and you grow with them, all that stuff, and you see everything, how it's developing in technology, right immediately. And then if you're a very much attuned, you say, wait a minute, look at all these flaws, look at the situation, you see how it really is beyond all the glamour of the advertising, you know. You see, you know the people, you know what's going on. You realize all the power struggles, all the junk that's going on, and the you know, you just, whoa, it's not, you know, the rest of the world's just thinking, ah, look at this, you know, look, here's the future, here's what you really want, you know, it's right here. You can send videos, and you can send multimedia anywhere, and you can work with multimedia, and everyone says, yeah, that's great, we don't need to seek anymore, we got it right here on our plasma screen, you know, and our 1,000 channels. But when you're at the epicenter of it and know how that all developed and everything around it, then you see it, you just realize, oh, it's just belief misleading us once again. You know, well, we don't get personal here, so, but just keep it general. So when you recognize what other people are seeking for isn't it, then you get ahead of the game, ahead of the game. We also had some heavyweight gurus come through here, especially in Marin County, and you're aware of that too as that unfolds. And of course, and we also had the whole music scene, you know, in San Francisco, etc., of in the 60s, how that unfolded, the whole music scene. But then the guru scene came on the coattails of the music scene in San Francisco and in Marin County and various places like Santa Cruz, etc. And you get in on all that too from early on, and you see all that, how that develops. And then you see, whoa, you know, these gurus are mostly teaching from belief, from a standpoint of belief. And boy, you know, the stuff that happened, you know, you see through the glamour of it, and you realize, hey, it's not so glamorous at all, not at all. And then again, you get down to business. You say, let's find out, you know, what we really want. How can we find what we really want? What is it, and how can we get it? Because it's not this stuff that the belief keeps giving us, you know. It's not the traveling around the world, you know, being a vagabond, a bohemian. It's not a bohemian. It's not a vagabond. It's not a musician. It's not a drug addict. Okay? It's not a guru. It's not the guru culture, kind of, the new guru culture. It's not a high tech. Okay? It's not any of that stuff. It's not any of that stuff. So you kind of, you know, you take those off the board and you say, what's left on the board? And you're looking at this board, and at some point you realize it's behind the board. It's behind the board. You move the board aside. It's not on the board. Now, apropos of that, I've been having some very strange dreams lately. They're very similar dreams. And let me see if I can explain these to you. Let's say I'm in a dream, And let's say I'm like on a cliff overlooking the Pacific Ocean, and the ocean is like, and there's a big storm in the ocean, you know, and there's the behind me there are hills, you know, the foothills, and there's a kind of a cliff there, and there's a beach, and there's the ocean, and there's a whole environment, the sky, you know, and it's just like, and it's really very chaotic, a lot of turmoil there. And so I'm in the dream, I'm watching this, and then suddenly there's something in me that says, I don't really want this. I want something else. And what happens is the entire scene, the entirety of it, as it were, like it was a stage setting, a stage setting, it all suddenly moves away together, the entirety. And then behind it, I'm seeing this incredibly beautiful land of milk and honey. I mean, just a beautiful, beautiful, serene place. I say, oh my gosh, that's what I really want to go there. And the whole entire Pacific Ocean, the West Coast, it is all simply moved aside as if it were like pivoting on some revolving stage, you know, like there's these like circular stages, you know, in music concerts where it's in the round, the stage keeps revolving, and you see the band, you know, in front. It's also in some stage productions, they have a huge, the stage is circular and it turns, and they're able to have build different scenes, you know, different areas, and you turn it, and one scene is completely gone, and the next scene, boom, is there in its entirety. It was like that. The whole scene, I saw it all depart as one package, departed together, and behind it was this incredibly beautiful situation. Now, last night I had another dream just like that. I was in a situation where everything was muddy, extremely muddy, mud everywhere. Everything was mired in mud, like there was been some huge flood or something, just, you know, thick mud, cars stuck in mud, houses all muddy, everything was muddy. And I was tromping through this mud, and I said, I'm trying to get somewhere, and I was dealing with some super complex, difficult problem of how do I get out of this mud. And then all of a sudden, the entirety of this whole scene of mud, it all pivoted together as one away, and in its place behind this scene that was there was this bay, this body of water that was completely serene and calm and beautiful. It was unbelievable. I looked at it, I said, how is that possible? Because, you know, before I realized there was this very, you know, catastrophic situation going on with the mud and storm, etc. And now there's this complete, suddenly behind there's all this complete serenity. So I got in the water and I was swimming and I swam through this bay, and it was just like so calm and beautiful. And I said, what's going on? And then I looked out far in the distance, out to the ocean. And there, out there in the open ocean, I saw it was still storming out there, the white caps and the storm was there. And I realized that somehow this storm was not touching where I was at all. It was untouched by it. And I was saying, whoa, you know, this is remarkable, just remarkable. And how did that all this, you know, disaster and mud and everything just pivoted away in total, completely away, is gone, and behind it was this serenity. So I'm saying that as we're looking for stuff on the board of existence, you know, is this it, and taking all this stuff off the board, okay, it's not this, netty, it's not this, and we're staring at the board, and we're saying, come on, can't somebody put something on the board, you know, write something on the board, give me a picture, give me some multimedia on this board, you know, I gotta find it, you know, we're desperate to find it. But how we find it is actually to roll this board off stage, the board itself, and behind the board we will find the effects of the new idea that we've already chosen. The effects will be there for us. That board is the board of belief. And so we're trying to find something within belief that can make us somehow free of belief. Can't do it. The board gets in the way. The board gets in the way. The board is the board of belief. It doesn't matter if you've got a blank board, if you erase everything on the board's still there, it's still belief. And they'll ask for something else to be put on the board. You can project a movie on the board if you want to. That's not it. So in most dreams, these dreams I'm having are completely different than any other dreams I've ever had. It's fundamentally different. Because in most dreams, it's like you're watching a movie on a screen, kind of as it were, and one scene will stop, another scene will replace it, like a fade. It'll fade or cross fade or different types of ways of just suddenly there's a different, you know, scene on the movie screen, as it were. But what if we were to just simply, the whole movie's still playing on the screen, and yet the whole screen moves away, and the whole movie theater and everything just moves away, and you are looking at, you know, something entirely different. It's not on the screen at all. That's the kind of dreams that I've been having, and never had those before. So somehow in the dream I recognized. I said, "Whoa, this is different. This is something that I've never experienced before." So there's some kind of awareness while dreaming that you're having a different kind of dream. Isn't that interesting? It was not a lucid dream. It's not like I said, "Oh, I know I'm dreaming." No, it was something like saying, "Oh, whoa, wait a minute. I'm able to shift, make a shift here where the whole thing shifts all together, all as one, shifts all as one, not as a process, but as one shift." And I actually played with it in the dream. I actually brought like that ocean back, the Pacific Ocean and all its turmoil back, and it covered up the land of milk and honey. And then I shifted it again back and uncovered it again, and I shifted it back. And I was actually playing with it like this to see what was going on. And I realized there's some kind of ability I have to shift it, make the shift completely like that. We have this ability within us. There's an ability to do it. So I would say, you know, I would presume that's auspicious. Because it seems to be in line with what we've been saying here, is a belief is a package deal, and you need to move all of belief, you know, everything that move the entire screen. Don't change the movie on that is projecting on the screen. Move the screen itself out of your perception entirely, and so nothing can be projected. You're not seeing anything that's being projected on a screen at all. You're seeing behind the screen. You're seeing the effects that lie beyond the memory of belief. You're seeing the effects of the idea of not trying to be prime creator, unconditional love. You're experiencing, perceiving those effects, and they're not on some screen. Or if they are, it's certainly not the screen of belief. Maybe it's its own screen of unconditional love. And the screen of belief is the screen itself that needs to be moved out of your way. And of course, when you move a screen, as it were, let's say there's a projection on a screen, the projection and the screen are one, you know, there's one package. When you move that screen, you also move the projection on that screen out of your perception, right? Everything that's being projected on the screen, no matter what it is, goes with the screen. It's not there anymore. It's not there. And that's what I was experiencing. And I saw this belief come back. I brought it back. I saw it was like blocking out, you know, what was behind it, as it were. And it was when I saw that blocking out, I was completely unaware there's anything behind it. And I kept thinking, how do I calm the ocean down? You know, I see this tumultuous ocean. How do I calm that down? And then suddenly I said, wait a minute, let me try this. And the whole ocean moved away and gone with the screen. And behind it was a scene of bucolic pastoral beauty that was just like incredible. My gosh, this river winding itself through this land of milk and honey and beautiful sandy beaches on the river, you know, and these trees and oasis, you know, it was just like the atmosphere and the sky and everything. I just said, wow, looks like an incredibly beautiful place. And then I brought back the ocean, and suddenly there's a storming Pacific Ocean. And I said, oh my gosh, how am I going to calm the waters? And then I moved it away again. I said, ah, there's the oasis again. I don't need to do anything with the Pacific Ocean. I don't need to calm it down. Just need to move the screen where it's being projected. Move that aside. And so within the dream, as I was dreaming, I was playing with the dream. Isn't that interesting? Changing what's going on in the dream consciously there. Which was a first. I can never ever remember doing that before. And deciding within the dream, deciding what do I want to experience within the dream. How many times have we ever done that where we're dreaming, we say, no, wait a minute. I think I don't want this experience this. I'm going to move this aside and I'm going to experience something else that's behind this. And that's better, you know. How often do we dream like that? Maybe it's a type of lucid dreaming. Conscious dream a certain way. I wasn't aware that I'm, you know, my body's in a bed sleeping or something. That, you know, wasn't, but I was consciously working with the dream and recognizing there's some kind of dynamic here that is deceptive dynamic that is obscuring something, you know, and that can move it aside simply by choosing to do so. Just a choice. There was no mantra. There was no tantra or mantra or any technique or prayer or song or dance or anything like that. It was just a simple choice. Simple choice. It was a mental, I realized it was like a mental, it was like a choice thing. It wasn't like formula, you know, like an intellectual thing. It was simply, I said, okay, what do I want to experience? I asked myself, what do I prefer to experience? What do I really want to experience? And I said, I want to experience the land of milk and honey. And then the whole ocean scene, you know, wiped right, you know, exited stage right, as it were. And I said, okay, let me see. I want to bring back the ocean scene. And it came back. And I said, okay, now I want to experience the oasis. The ocean scene, all as a package. The screen that was projected on moved away. And I said, okay. And then I said, there's some secret here that I just discovered of how to get what I really experience, what I really want. And I was dreaming. I was aware of this in the dream. And I said, okay, I want to know what's going on here. And I think I figured it out, you know. That's happening in the dream. Then when I eventually woke up, I remembered this. I was aware of it. So you see, there is something at play. There really is something at play. We're not on a wild goose chase here. Belief is on a wild goose chase. Belief will put you on a wild goose chase. Promise you the moon. And I promise you, deliver the moon on a silver platter to you. But it's only on a screen, you know. It's not what you really want. You want the effects of choosing the idea of not trying to change reality. You want to experience those effects, absolutely. No question about it. And those effects are already there. But they're being obscured by the memory of belief and the chicanery that belief brings about, believes in the turmoil, and the belief that somehow your happiness comes from calming the turmoil. It does not. Let's say you have a world full of barbarians hacking everyone and each other to pieces, which is essentially what this world has been, and you decide, I don't really want this. The whole world can be moved aside, and behind that world, where what was obscured is you see a world of perfect peace behind that, which is the effect of the idea of not trying to change reality, not wanting to be prime creator. It's there. It's already there. That's what Jesus tells us. He said, it's already there. The real world is already there. It's been there. The moment we chose a different idea, it was there. It's there right now. Yeah, but we keep superimposing the memory of belief and how belief, you know, plays upon it. And we keep wanting that to be real, so we don't, you know, that's what we're perceiving. That's what we're perceiving. But when we finally are able to stop trying to manipulate what the effects of belief, and just move the whole thing aside as one package, then we'll see what's behind it. But as long as we are trying to manipulate the effects of it, we won't see what's behind it. We'll still see the world. The screen will still be there. We're just projecting, trying to project different stuff on the screen. But the screen is still there. It's still obscuring what's behind it. So as you're going through this storm, Sandy, and the various storms to come, such as the election, which is bound to become very interesting based on the loss of electricity in a lot of places and the troubles of people getting to the polls, trouble right now of people early voting, can't do it, etc., etc. So you can see the quagmire that we're headed into. Okay, there's a quagmire now being projected onto the screen of belief. Okay? But you can get a sense of what's being said here is you can actually move this entire scenario aside. You don't have to be experiencing that. Don't have to. Now, how do we know? You know, I'm speaking from direct experience within this dream of being able to do it. I haven't done it at the most, I would call, unconscious of levels, which is actually the day-to-day living. When we are going about our day, we're actually the most unconscious time. That is the depths of unconsciousness, as it were, because we're just dealing with driving and, you know, tasks and stuff. When we sleep, we go into much more conscious state, okay, where we're starting to deal with much more aware of the dynamics of what's going on with us. And then when we wake up in the morning, poof, it's all gone. I mean, I've had many times while I'm sleeping where I've been able to iron out major confusion, etc. When I wake up in the morning, it fades away as I say, well, what am I going to have for breakfast? Get a shower, get breakfast. I've got to get going to work, you know, brush, shower, and this, and deal with boom, 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 rush. And, you know, it fades away. It fades away. So, but there are some in the world who had this consciously, even in the day-to-day functioning. As they function day-to-day, it was perfectly clear to them, perfectly clear. And so we can go on their testimony, right? Very reliable testimony. And I go on the testimony of my ma, who was actually here in this world just very recently, 1896 to 1982. And people ask her about what's going on in the world. They'd say, hey, you know, everybody's hacking each other to pieces. You know, how do you feel about this? And she says, I'm not perceiving that at all. She says, I don't perceive a world of trouble at all. What I perceive, I'm experiencing, is perfection, utter perfection, total peace, perfection, and love, unconditional love. That's what she was experiencing all the time, and yet could function flawlessly here. And so it is possible to actually experience what you really want to experience, even while you're here in the world, and you can still function in the world. You're experiencing unconditional love that can never be threatened whatsoever. And so, since it can't be threatened, you're not perceiving any threats to it. See, that is the key. You still perceive people, but they're not perceived as threats. There's no threat perceived anywhere. And it's understood that other people are perceiving threats because they're still watching the movie of belief. Okay, reruns of the movie. We're watching reruns. The movie was made long ago, and we're just watching it reruns over and over and over and over again. We're watching the movie of belief that was produced, you know, eons ago. And it was over with eons ago. It was done. You know, chose a different idea, but yet we're still watching the Rocky Horror Show, you know, for the umpteenth time. The belief horror show. For the billionth time, we're watching it. Every day, every night, we watch this rerun of this movie. But we don't have to. But we can realize others are watching it. Sure, we know that. And, you know, like, if they're trying to bring trauma on themselves, like, one of Ananda Maima's very closest devotees. It might have been her husband or one of her closest devotees. I can't quite remember. A cobra. He was walking along and there was a cobra, and she suddenly jumped in front of him and stuck her foot out, and the cobra bit her foot. And it was obvious that if she hadn't done that, this devotee was going to get bit by the cobra or some situation like that. And everyone was freaking out. She says, "Don't worry, don't worry, no trouble here at all." And first there seemed to be something happening, and then very quickly, poof, you know, gone, nothing. So for her, it's not a threat. There's nothing that's a threat. Nothing threatened her. But she allowed for the sacred devotees to participate in, you know, where they were at, which is to watching this movie of trauma and belief, to, you know, kind of interface with that in some way. But from her standpoint, there was never any threat at all in any way. But she was aware of others being threatened. For one time, she suddenly disappeared and came back like soaking wet or something, and later we found out that one of her devotees had slipped and fell into, there was a flood waters in the Ganges or something, and they couldn't swim and they were going to drown, and suddenly she appeared there and whoosh, pulled them out of the Ganges like that and saved their life that way. And so she was aware that someone was believing in threat, and this belief in threat was playing out in their make-believe scenario of belief, and that they had sufficient desire to awaken from this dream so that it was okay to, you know, pull them out of the Ganges at that point so they could continue on with their awakening from the dream. So those kind of things happened all the time. She would, you know, mitigate some of the threat on trauma on people so that they could continue their focus. Otherwise, you know, they might have either died or gotten real sick, et cetera, et cetera. But other times, you know, she would say, hey, you know, the karma is such that I'm not mitigating it isn't beneficial. So, I mean, her husband died of smallpox, the bad kind. And she didn't, you know, mitigate that. Until the very end, she took away the pain like that, took it away, but didn't heal, you know, get rid of the smallpox. Whereas in other situations, she could get rid of various things easily if it was indicated that in doing so, it would result in greater progress towards awakening. Whereas if you take away something like a sickness from someone, it can actually cause greater delay in certain circumstances because it freaks people out. And they get into magic, they get into esotericism, they get into all this stuff. They're trying to figure out a way to manipulate belief, which actually delays their awakening. It delays them from moving that board aside completely, a board of belief. It gets them engaged in trying to manipulate belief, put something on that board, you know, project a better movie on the screen instead of moving the whole screen away. So that it would actually delay them from awakening. So the true guru knows which situation is which is actually would lessen delay, and which situation would actually increase delay. If it increases delay, they won't do it. They won't do it. They let whatever happens, happens, in that, you know, whatever trauma happens, they let it happen. But they're always willing to negate, you know, some trauma if it's actually beneficial, if it's actually would help lessen delay. For sure. That's not a problem for them. What kind of problem is it for them to intercede in a dream? It's only dream stuff. It's nothing for them. They just use their complete pure awareness of spirit to simply change the dream a little bit. You know, someone's dreaming of smallpox and now they're not dreaming of smallpox. She just said, okay, this one, there's no more dream of smallpox for you. Gone. There's no more dream of cancer for you. Gone. Like that. And if they say, yeah, I'm happy it's gone. I didn't really want it anymore. You know, that's fine. If they say, where did my dream of cancer go? You know, oh, I'm freaking out. Well, my dream of cancer is gone. Where is it? What happened to it? I want to know how you got rid of it. What, you know, that's bad. Whereas a devotee would just say, ah, Thank you, Ma. It was great. I didn't really want it in the first place, you know. It was just a stupid old habit of mine. And she would say, yeah, it was just a habit for you. You didn't really want it, so gone. And then they just move right on to awakening, pushing the whole board aside, the screen aside, instead of trying to manipulate, place stuff on the screen, instead of manipulate what's going on the screen, trying to produce some better movie to project on that screen. The better movie's already been produced. It's just waiting for us there to see it. That's it. The better movie, the movie we really want to see, has already been produced. The instant we chose a new idea, that better movie was produced, and it's been playing constantly for us, and it's right there for us. All we have to do is to be willing to move the screen of belief aside, and there. Because it can never be projected on the screen of belief. It's impossible. Because the screen of belief is a denial of reality, and the screen of belief itself is constantly actually not stable at all. As you get this feeling of instability and from the screen itself. So you cannot project what we really want upon the screen of belief. We'll not come across the right way at all. We'll just strengthen fear, is what it will strengthen. So we have to move the entire screen aside. No matter what's on it, doesn't matter what's being projected on it. So it doesn't matter what is being projected on your screen of belief, whether it's a storm, calm, whatever. It doesn't matter. Just move the whole screen away. Just move it aside. Like you're on a stage and just moving the stage scenery. Just move it aside, and that play, that tableau, the mise-en-scene of where the action's happening, what's happening, you know, is a gaslighted street, you know, in some dingy fishing town or village, you know, moved aside, and now it's some beautiful calm lake, you know, and an oasis or something. And it's like that. You experience the effects of the movie. Now you can still be aware of the of everything that's going on around you, but also you can have greater depth to your awareness. Much greater depth. You just know that nothing real is being can be threatened. You know it for a fact. So if nothing real can be threatened, what is threat? How can something be unreal be threatened? What kind of meaning does that have? The unreal is being threatened. Is that a real threat? No, it can't possibly be. It must be a delusion. It must be insanity. It doesn't stand up to reason at all. I mean, you know, how can you threaten nothing? You know, you can say you're threatening nothing, but how much of a threat needs to be mounted for nothing? I mean, what meaning does it have to threaten nothing? It doesn't have any meaning. It's like that. I mean, what kind of meaning is there in a mirage, really? You know, there's no real meaning at all in a mirage. Nothing's really going on there at all, because poof, it's gone. And you're like, there's nothing there in the first place. That's just an analogy. Of course, you realize a mirage is a reflection bouncing off of something substantial, but the analogy is apt, you know. Belief is just presenting the mirage of plausibility. So you have a plausible threat. Of course, there's plausible threats, absolutely, but not a real threat. All the trauma is plausible threat, plausible trauma, but reality is not real threat. It's not real trauma at all. None of it. It never has been and never will be. So we are attempting to move the narrative to the point where, apparently, the awareness of our capability to move the whole screen aside begins to dawn upon us, as it has the last couple nights with me. Actually, it started on, I believe, the night of the 27th. Could have been, and then last night was the night of the 28th of October. So I've always said I had my breakthroughs in this time frame of late October, and I guess the breakthroughs are happening. That's a very significant breakthrough to realize that there is this capability to shift the entire scenery aside, move it, and behind it is what you really want to see. And the recognition that there is this ability to do that is, you know, that's in the ballpark to what we want to, where we want to reach. It's in the ballpark, for sure. I don't know how close it is, really, but it's got to be in the ballpark. Has to be. Can't not be in the ballpark, because it's the essential thing we're trying to do. It's what we need to do. And right now I'm just kind of like, you know, filling in the details. For instance, that it's always, you know, we dropped belief long ago, and this chose a different idea long ago. It's already been done. The effects are already here. The new movie is already there. All, you know, all that. That's just filling in the details and saying, okay, I don't need to do anything to sustain it. It's already there. The movie's already there. It's already playing. I just need to move the screen, this other screen, aside. That's all. So, you know, it moves the narrative forward, kind of puts it in the right context, the situation in the right context. Now, consciously right now, what you would, as you say, I'm in a state of almost stupefaction. In when we're consciously focusing in the daytime, it's like stupefaction, severely. In this state of stupefaction, I'm not aware of any ability to do that. I'm not aware of it. But obviously, just beneath the surface, I am aware of it because I was doing it. So this state of stupefaction we call everyday consciousness needs to be infused with that awareness of the ability to do this and to do it in order to reassure others, to really reassure others that it's truly there. Even the state of stupefaction has to be brought into alignment with that. And that's the part that hasn't taken place yet. And whether it will or not, who's to say? Who's to say? I can't even say at this point. Because how can I, from a state of stupefaction, say that, you know? But from the subtler, from more aware levels, where not so severely stupefied, I've gotten lots of indications that, you know, it is trending in that direction. But from the state of stupefaction, I don't know if it's so or not. There's not real certainty in stupefaction, is there? How could there be? When you're stupefied, how can you be certain? Whatever conclusion you reach, you would say, something within you would say, yeah, but I reached that conclusion in a state of stupefaction, so how trustworthy can it possibly be? And therein lies, you know, some difficulty. Because we when we're meditation, contemplation, inquiry, satsang, dreaming, when we sleep, we get all these clarifications, and then when we wake up and go into stupefaction, we say, you know, I'm not really sure if any of that stuff can really be trusted at all. I'm not really sure about that. We start to doubt. And how can we not doubt? In a state of stupefaction, we have to doubt. It's impossible to be certain in a state of stupefaction. It's like if you're like some person that's just super drunk, you know, and they think they're seeing stuff, you know, and they say, well, you know, I don't know, I'm so messed up, you know, it's may not be right, you know. Whatever, in a state of stupefaction, you know, you're going to not trust your experiencing very much. So as this awareness fades, and I wake up in the morning, awareness fades, I'm saying, well, you know, I'm not sure. Maybe that was just a dream. But it's actually this state of stupefaction of everyday conscious living. That's, you know, the depths of the dream. That is really so deep dreaming, very deep dreaming. And it's the other stuff that's not as deep a dreaming, actually. in this state of stupefaction is just the last worn-out habit, old habit of watching that old rerun of belief. That's all it is. It's just that, you know, habitual get up and watch the rerun. That's what we do. Life is like a dream. It's like a movie. We get up in the morning, we watch the rerun. Same old thing every day. Groundhog Day. Which is one of the few movie references I'll ever make. I don't advise anybody to make pop cultural references, but Groundhog Day is basically a situation where someone wakes up and every day the same things happen over and over, exactly the same. And so really, every day is Groundhog Day for us. And in spite of all the supposed variety, you know, it's still Groundhog Day. Everything is the same. It's the same movie. As the movie of belief, it's being projected on the screen of belief. Same screen, you know, screen of belief. And the reflection from the screen is a reflection of belief. So that's why it's the same old movie, really. And all the themes are the same. Everything, all the deceit is the same. The denials of reality are all the same. All the belief in the impossible is the same. All the fear is the same. All the vulnerability, the trauma, everything's the same. It's all the same. And yet we get up and we keep hoping it's going to be different. How can it be different? Same old screen, same old theme, same old movie. And we wonder, what can we do? What can we do to make it better? You know, we always hear that. We got to make it better. Let's do something to make it better. And we're so engaged in that, we never, ever, ever think about moving the whole screen aside. We never even think about it. How many of you have even, you know, ever thought about that and saying, wait a minute. I wonder, you know, if there's some other option other than trying to sugarcoat the screen. Yeah, it's, you know, it's nothing wrong with, from the level of belief, to do that stuff. What is mistaken is to believe that is somehow going to get you what you really want to experience. It will not. Sure, you can do all the charities in the world, but it is not going to change. It's not going to give you what you really want at all. And yet that is what we are all taught to do and all believe we must do. And of course, it's beyond any teaching. I hear a lot of talk about how our problems are due to our parents, our teachers, and our priests and pastors and rabbis and et cetera, you know, religious teaching, all our conditioning. It's not due to that at all. It's not due to our conditioning. It's due to because we want belief to be true. That comes way before any of this conditioning. That's primary, you know, for us. It comes from extreme long habit that we've been engaged in. We come into this world, we're not a tabula rasa, we're not a blank slate. You know, people look at children like they're completely blank slate. Well, of course, the functioning of perception is not yet attuned to this world. So what? It takes a while for them to, you know, get their perception going. But as far as their inner habits, okay, those are habitual for eons, you know. Wanting belief to be true and following along with the movie of belief, watching the movie of belief. They may have seen it, you know, billions of times, a movie of belief. Before they're, you know, born again into another body, they have another sensory suit, put on another sensory suit to, you know, watch the movie here in this world of belief again. They have all those tendencies already there, all the habits already there, and it comes out as they start to grow up. It comes to the front, and the parents realize, wow, you know, this child, you know, is very different than this other one. They have all these very strong tendencies to them. Of course, they didn't come from teachers, parents, you know, priests and pastors, rabbis, etc. They didn't come from there. Those had, you know, played a minor role, but no, not the major role at all. No way, no way. You know, so, you know, the idea we got to get free of our conditioning. It's the conditioning is epic, you know. The habit of watching the screen of belief extends back into the very beginning of time for us. And so don't lay it on your parents or your teachers or your religious instructors at all. Forget about that. The idea that somehow we come in here into this world totally innocent is absolutely ridiculous. And yet you hear that over and over and over and over, as if we all come in here completely innocent and the world corrupts us. That is completely false. Every one of us has, from the beginning of time, have been fixated on the screen of belief and everything projected on that screen of belief. And we carry that with us into through as we cycle through all the different cycles of belief, all the subtle realms, then cycling back to the more gross realms until we find ourselves in this monkey suit. We carry that with us the entire time. It's our habit. It's because we want belief to be true. It's not because any parent or teacher or anything instilled this in us. We use as an excuse, as a scapegoat. We use those as a scapegoat. Our parents, teachers, and religious instructors, etc., society, culture. We scapegoat them to distract ourselves from the truth, the real truth of the situation. And that is, we need to move the entire screen, all as one, and see. The fact is that we've already chosen a new idea. We use that to obscure this fact. And that we're only living on memories of belief, rerunning these memories in our mind. Now, of course, if we see the parents and teachers and religious instructors, culture, rerunning all these memories in their mind, that, of course, kind of, you know, it has a certain kind of pressure on us to rerun the memories in our mind too. Yeah, but the tendency we have is already extreme within us. You know, and those, when we come into this world, nobody's putting those extreme tendencies there. We come in, we come with them, we carry them with us. As we cycle through all the life and afterlife, we carry all those tendencies with us. And there's only one tendency everyone has, which is to watch this rerun. You know, it's all basically the very same thing. Watch the rerun. So, at some point, we have to get away from blaming anybody for this. Instead, blame ourselves for wanting belief to be true. Wanting to change reality. And not blame. It's not blame. We simply need to recognize it. Because we didn't cause any trouble to reality. We didn't threaten reality. We didn't threaten ourselves. We didn't threaten, nothing can, you know, there's nothing, belief is nothing. So nothing was ever been threatened. Nothing real has ever been threatened. So it's not a blame, it's simply a recognition. Just recognize it. This is what we've done. Recognize it. Say, okay, I wanted belief to be true. I wanted to reach the goal. I wanted belief to give me a way to change reality. And so I've been watching these reruns for so long. And now I'm tired of these reruns. I'm going to move the whole screen away that the reruns are playing on. And the reruns can stay with that screen. It will, but that screen is out of my perception now. No longer part of my perception. A different attitude. There's no blame, no scapegoating. Get away from all that stuff, scapegoating. It doesn't solve anything. It just gives power to what's outside, what you think's outside of you, belief. It just gives more power to belief. My teachers, they're the ones who are to blame. For a while it seems that way. For a while it seems that way. As long as you believe your salvation comes from what you put on this board, manipulating what you put on this board, fixing what you put on this board, changing it, arranging it, mosaicing it in a different way, then you will tend to blame others. But as soon as you see that the salvation comes from moving the entire board out of your perception, then you don't blame others. You won't blame others. You say, oh, my gosh, I have the power within me to do this, to save salvations within me. I have the power to do it. I have the capability to do it. Nobody can stop me. I always had this within me. Nobody ever interfered with this capability or power. I just was deluded because I wanted belief to be true. I was deluded into thinking I needed to manipulate belief, put what's on the board, what's on the screen, instead of moving the screen. So you will go through a phase of blaming others, thinking that Others, you know, fed you this line of bull when you're growing up. All these lies and deceptions, you know, fairy tales and all this, which is true. That's exactly, you know, and education is not education, it's indoctrination. And you're completely, you know, severely indoctrinated. All that is so. But the power has always been within you to get free of that like that. So the question is, why haven't you exercised that power? Were they preventing you? No, they were not. It was our own desire that belief find a way to change reality that kept us engaged with this. You see, that's the real cause of it. That's the cause of it. Not anybody, not anyone is causing it. Just our own, the fact we want to be prime creator, want to experience that. That is what is causing it. Nothing else. And again, we dropped that desire. We've dropped that idea already, long ago. It's already dropped. And so we are just still living on memories, living on fumes, you know, of this, still kind of just, you know, keep watch the movie one more time, see if it turns out differently. We've watched the movie billions of times, and we still want to watch it one more time to see if it turns out differently. And we go to bed at night and realize, ah, same old movie, it didn't turn out differently. Then we say, one more day, we'll go, one more chance, and then another. One drink, just one more, and then another. That's the story. It's like we're in a bar, and we say, yeah, give me one drink, I just have just one more. And then finish and say, and then another. And then another, and another, and another, and another. And you end up in assisted living place, and the body rots away, and you go into the afterlife, and you cycle through that, and you get, and your desire to, for belief to be true, presents itself in some persuasive way to, you know, go back, cycle back through into putting on a meat suit again. And you keep doing it, and keep watching the movie again. Just keep watching the same movie over and over and over. So, the truth is that we can move, don't worry about the movie, move the whole screen. Don't worry about the movie, move the screen. Don't worry about what's appearing in your life. Just move the whole screen of your life, poof, like that. And again, it's not your body, that you're not attacking your body. Because as again, the afterlife is the same problem. It's no different. Just you have a more subtle body in the afterlife. So, no, moving the screen is deciding to see what's behind belief. What's the effects of this other idea you've already chosen? The idea of not trying to be prime creator. What are those effects? So it's moving the screen aside so you can see these effects are already there. And it's not your body that will perceive it. It's not your sensory perception of external stuff that is going to perceive what's behind sensory perception. What's behind the screen of belief, which is, you know, sensory perception. Perception of that type. What is behind that? And then there's this awareness of this other movie. But it's not awareness that comes through the eyes, through the ears, through the nose, through sensory perception. So you don't have to attack the body or do anything. Sensory perception can still be there, but it has nothing to do with seeing what is behind sensory perception. And you've just realized that. And since you're not trying to manipulate sensory perception anymore, it doesn't become an issue anymore. There's no interference because you're not realize you don't need to do anything with sensory perception in order to. You don't need to get rid of it. You don't need to manipulate it. You don't need to augment it or decrease it or do anything at all. Because you're not even using it to see what's behind it. And it's not interfering. And there you go. So, I don't know what's going on with Sandy right now. What time is it back there? It's 1:30 in the morning. It's probably, you know, Everybody's still freaking out, probably. Those who is hit, that it's hit, and those are getting hit, and those who will hit, and you know, everybody's collectively going through a collective freak out. It's, you know, in the videos I've done in the past, I've told you and warned you about there's just going to be this collective hysteria on this planet. And that's the problem. It's not, you know, you think you're dealing with your own panic. No, you're dealing with the panic of everyone around you. Everyone in the media feeding that panic. Everyone in the community, your friends, family, community, you know, area, media, everything. It's a collective thing. And I said, that is the danger that is coming for you. Is this collective freak out that is coming. And now you're seeing it, you know, with this Sandy thing, is a collective freak out. People are, you know, just saying, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, you know, is this terrible? It's going to be bad. It's going to be really bad. You know, and of course they'll get through it. Of course they'll get through it. But this exercise and collective freak out is not a good thing. It is not a good thing. Because then the next freak out comes along and it gets worse and worse and worse. And you think, oh, I'm used to collective freak out. I can do this. And which is why when there's troubles, I tend to get away and don't get pulled into this collective freak out. Because, the storm will dissipate and, you know, water will recede and people will put their lives back together and things will go on like that. Until the next trauma, which will be, you know, soon and coming. Now it's basically a cavalcade of trauma coming up, which has all been foreseen and warned about. So if you have your attention on, hey, you know, satsang, and where is this going, and recognizing, hey, wait a minute, there's something really here, then you'll say, I don't need the collective freak out. I really don't need it. I don't need to do that. I don't need to manipulate what's on the board, what's on the screen. That's not it at all. What's it is I need to get that willingness to move the whole screen. And that willingness is within me. I'm just not exercising it. It's like swallowing, you know. You can swallow or, you know, breathe in your nose or blink your eyes or raise your hands. You know, you can do that, but you might not do it. You might keep your eyes open now. You might close them. You know, it's a decision. Say, I'm going to close my eyes now. Okay, I'll close my eyes. So we're able to make decisions of what we're going to do in the body. I'm going to raise my hand. I'm going, okay, boom, raise my hand. I'm going to put it down. Okay, I put it down. We're able to do that, and we don't question that at all. It's just automatic, right? But we also have the ability to move the entire scene, the whole screen, away from our perception. This is just a simple decision. Just as simple as saying we're going to raise our hand. Just that simple. And yet we think it's some super difficult thing to do. It is not. You know, as babies, as children, you know, we learn how to make decisions to move our body and, you know, and speak and do all these things. And we actually kind of work at it and make the connection like, hey, I can do this. You know, the baby realizes, hey, I can do this stuff. I can do it. I'm going to drop that. You know, I can drop that. Wow, I can drop it. And starts gradually realizing, you know, hey, this I can do stuff. And we gradually realize that we can move this whole movie screen aside as one. Everything, you can have a movie of the whole universe on that screen, right? And you can move the screen aside. The whole movie of the universe goes with that screen. Or can you have a movie of a planet, country, person, situation, whatever's on there, it goes as you move the screen. It makes no difference, right? How heavy that screen is. Let's say you're projecting on that screen a planet. Okay, and you move the screen. Let's say the screen is on wheels. You wheel it off the stage. How heavy is that screen? Okay, wheel it back. Now put a projected movie of a universe on that screen. Now wheel that screen off the stage. How heavy is the screen now? Is there any difference in weight? None, right? No difference at all. Project a feather on the screen. Wheel the screen off. Is it any lighter? No, it's no lighter. It's the exact same weight. No matter what you're projecting on a screen, it's the exact same weight. The screen is the exact same weight. It doesn't change the weight at all. But as long as we don't we don't recognize that we need to wheel that screen off, we'll be looking at it and saying, my gosh, you know, there's a whole universe on the screen. I need to make it lighter. How do I make it lighter? You know, it's so heavy now. I need to lighten up, lighten it up, lighten it up. I need to lighten up what's being projected on the screen. I need to get that feather on the screen. You know, and I can't do it until I get that feather on the screen. And you work to get a feather on the screen, and then suddenly you get a feather on a screen, and boom, you know, something else drops on the screen. You say, oh, you know, like a Roadrunner cartoon, you know, a safe drops on the screen, kaboom. And you say, oh, I almost had the screen light enough to, you know, to move it, but now a heavy safe is on. I got to get rid of that safe, you know. And a storm comes, and I can't. None of that is affecting the weight of the screen at all. Just move the screen, exact same weight, no matter what is being projected upon it. And again, let's say you have some massive war going on the screen. You're saying, oh my gosh, I got to bring peace to this situation before I'm able to, you know, do anything with the screen, because it's so chaotic here, I can't do anything with it. And so you work to get things peaceful, and you finally enough people have been killed, you know, people are tired of war, then, you know, there's a period of truce for a while, and you think, whew, okay, finally getting there, I'm almost there, you know, things have like gotten more harmonious, the screen feels more harmonious, I'm able to do something with it, I don't know what, but it feels like I can do something with it, so you're just getting ready to do something, you're not sure what it is, and then war breaks out again, boom. And you say, oh my gosh, no way can I do anything with this screen when all this chaos is going on the screen. Okay, but consider this. As far as wheeling that screen off the stage, does it make any difference what's being projected on it? Does it matter if there's some chaotic, terrible war on the screen, or is there some golden age on the screen? How does that affect you wheeling the screen off the stage in any way, shape, or form? Nothing. It doesn't become more difficult to wheel the screen off the stage if there's some chaotic war on the screen. It doesn't become any easier if there's some peace and harmony on the screen. It's still the exact same effort to just wheel the screen off the stage. Just that decision to do it. No difference at all. And so what are we doing worrying about what's on the screen? That's a complete misdirection of our attention, of what we need to be focused on. It doesn't make any difference what's on the screen. Now, having said that, of course, most people don't believe that. I mean, most people are caught up in belief, meaning they believe that what's on the screen is affecting their ability to somehow get what they really want, even though it's not. So given that fragile, you know, you may be gravitating towards realizing it doesn't matter. Okay, and if you're watching this video, of course you're gravitating that way. That doesn't really matter at all what's on the screen, to move that screen off the stage. But you're kind of fragile in this in this realization, in this acceptance. So from that standpoint, it does matter what's on the screen, as far as if stuff gets really chaotic and everybody's freaking out on the screen and you get caught up in this freak out, that you'll then start believing that it does matter what's on the screen, and you'll delay. So from that standpoint, it matters from a practical standpoint, not an absolute standpoint at all. From an absolute standpoint, it absolutely does not matter in the slightest bit. From a practical standpoint, for those who are getting to the absolute standpoint, temporarily it can seem to matter. And it's important for them, for you, to actually not get caught up in a freak out. And to have a situation where it might seem as if, you know, what's on the screen makes it easy to wheel the screen off. even though it doesn't make any difference, but it might, you know, there might, you know, there is some progress that can be made, as it were, towards strengthening realization that it doesn't matter what's on the screen. So, of course, it can help to make that progress. It can help, absolutely. I would like to be put in a situation where, it's, for me, it seems a lot, you know, I don't get pulled into believing it matters what's on the screen. Of course. Why not? It's helpful. But don't get wrapped up in whatever situation you're in, whether even if it seems helpful, don't get wrapped up in it. Don't get wrapped up in the situation. Get wrapped up in the realization that it doesn't matter what's on the screen. Okay, that's what's important. Of course, you can have gratitude that you're in a good situation for yourself. Good, sure. But the end point of that gratitude is to realize it doesn't matter. And to wheel that screen off the stage, and you'll see what's behind it. You'll see the movie behind the movie. There's a movie going on behind the movie of belief. Behind the movie is another movie, but it's a movie of unconditional love. And it's a movie that is what you really want to see as far as movies go. And then at some point you'll even go beyond movies. In the meantime, we'll watch this movie that we really want to watch, which is a movie where there's no threat at all. Nothing's being threatened. Nothing can be threatened. Nothing can be changed. Nothing is, everything is the isness is completely apparent. Is it completely apparent that nothing real can be threatened? That's the movie we really want to watch. So here we are, chatting away. I know back east it's the wee hours of the morning. You know, you've gotten into the darkest time now, you know, 1 o'clock in the morning, and it's, the wind is howling, gusting 100 miles an hour in places, and the rain is screaming, and the tree limbs are snapping, and you hear all these noises like boom, what's that, you know. I mean, don't think we don't have storms out here in California. We absolutely do. We get some extremely powerful storms here. They roll out the Pacific Ocean, and they can come in screaming. Winds 80 miles an hour, definitely. You feel the roof's going to be torn off, and you hear going stuff, thump, thump, you know, hitting the house. We've had terrible storms out here, very destructive. So know exactly, you know, what that can be like. And it's just, we haven't had any of those for a while. It's been quite a few years, actually, since we've had a real powerful storm here. Most of the storms come through have been quite gentle, very gentle. But Pacific Ocean can cough up some storms, believe me. So, yeah, there's all this boogeyman out there. You know, there's all this, you know, wrathful deities out there, you know, going berserk and rendering mayhem everywhere. And, you know, you're huddled down and you're like, you know, shaken, you know, you're afraid, you know, and all this kind of stuff. The movie's getting real nasty. The movie, I believe, is real nasty. Just keep in mind that behind this movie is another movie. And it's a beautiful oasis. Most peaceful place you've ever seen. My gosh, the sky is so azure blue, and the atmosphere is like nectar, you know. It's like drinking in fragrance, and the countryside is so, you see, it's so peaceful the way it looks, and the river is sparkling, and it's so fresh and clean, and the shade is so wonderful, and the beach there on the river is like so crystalline, so softly crystalline, and it's just like a paradise, you know. It's like this beautiful, beautiful oasis, you know, and it's just, you just feel like just, you know, hanging out there. Beautiful movie there, behind this wrathful, destructive, terrifying, intimidating movie is this completely peaceful movie where nothing is being threatened. And it's right behind it. Literally, if you can move the screen away, it is right there. It's already there. It's not something you have to get or piece together. You don't have to piece it together. It's already there. The entire movie's already been produced, and it's just running continuously. It's like on endless loop. And so you don't have to do anything with this other movie. Let this other movie be whatever it wants to be. Just move the screen aside and watch this other movie. Now, does that mean that, you know, the floodwaters recede and all that? It can. However it plays out for you, you know, absolutely it can play out that way. Ananda Maima was once in this religious satsang, and there was this tent, this building. They put up tents, basically poles and cloth and tents and whatever. And there, it was a monsoon season, and there was a lot of people under this tent. and the monsoon came and it became ferocious, and the people were terrified. And the rainwater was collecting on this tent, this big pavilion. And it got real heavy. It got heavier and heavier, accumulated water, and people were like freaking out, and they realized the whole thing's going to collapse. And yet Anandamayi Ma is continuing her, you know, the satsang without any concern whatsoever. And so everybody calmed down. They realized, they said, if she's not worried, we're not worried. And so it went on beautifully, and the whole program was completed perfectly. And then she got up and said, everybody vacate this tent immediately at the end of it. And everybody very quickly got out of the tent. And as soon as everybody was out of the tent, poof, it collapsed. It collapsed. But as long as she was in there, it could not collapse. It could not. That's a fact. So when you are watching this other movie and you've completely accepted, etc., again, you cannot be threatened. You cannot be threatened. And situations can arise where threat is held in abeyance, really is held in abeyance. You have many testimonies throughout the ages that places of worship, holy places in the world, or places of worship, you know, are not harmed by storms, are not harmed by trauma and disaster. Where miraculously, you know, you drop bombs and fires and everything, and this place, nothing touches it. It's untouched. It's unbelievable. Earthquake, some severe earthquake, and there's this place of worship that is untouched, completely untouched. And people say, that's incredible. How did it happen? And then, of course, there are other times when they do get touched, you know. So you can't put a blanket statement on it because it depends. It depends on what would bring about, what would lessen delay, what kind of lesson delay, you know. Anandamayi Ma really, you know, saw that this satsang was very important for people, and it would, the fact that a collapsing roof would actually delay their awakening, so no collapse could take place. She in the dream, she decided that there won't be a collapse in this dream right now. And then once the program's over and they left the pavilion, then she says, okay, you know, it would delay. Might delay if no collapse took place. So the collapse, boom, took place then. It's just a dream. This world is just a dream. And those who know it's just a dream can decide, you know, hey, this doesn't need to happen at this, you know, particular juncture or something. But it's just done for the pure sake of expediency of lessening delay. That's the only reason. In certain situations, and who knows what those situations are, but theoretically for sure, if you are really engaged in moving that screen aside, you know, you may just sail through the whole thing, just sail through it. That's very true, very true. For you, it will be not so bad at all, not so bad at all. Because you don't want to even get wrapped up in it. You're not really interested in it. He said, I'm not really interested in this movie. So you say, no reason for you to get wrapped up in it. And that literally affects the dream. It does affect the dream. But that affecting the dream is not the same as awakening from the dream. You've heard all the stuff about meditation. If you meditate, there's less violence. All this. Yeah, that's true. But that does not have to do with awakening from the dream. It does not have to do with moving the screen aside. It does not. It's still focused on affecting what's being projected on the screen. And that can, you know, it can be beneficial if you take it the right way, but not necessarily. You might say, everyone say, hey, if we just all meditate, we can stop all crime and we'll have this golden age and everything will be for great, which is delusion. It's not at all true. It's still, the screen of belief is still there entirely. So It depends, and you got to let the ones who are completely awake, let them deal with that. We don't have to worry about that at all, because only they can really truly discern, you know, what increases delay and what decreases delay, and only they have that perfect discernment. We don't have that. We don't need to worry about it. Just keep focusing on recognition that we don't need to worry about what's on the screen. A universe could be projected on the screen or a single speck of dust. It doesn't change the way of the screen. The wheeling away of the screen is equally, exactly the same, easy, with no matter what's projected on it. No difference. Just keep on hammering away at that. you know, or keep pulling that nail out of the coffin, you know, or keep, you're in the coffin, keep banging on that nail, you've loosened that nail up, and you're in this coffin, you know, this whole world is like a sarcophagus, you know, a crypt, we're all in this crypt, you know, and we're trying to get out of it, you know, and keep banging away on that nail, trying to pry away that lid of that coffin. And the realization is, all I need to do is just move this whole scene away. Just the whole screen, all together it goes. Move the screen away, and what's projected on it is no longer there, right? So just do that, and remove the lid of the coffin, the whole lid of the coffin. Boom, it's off. And you're not staring at that lid on the coffin and all your projected fears of death, and you're seeing, you know, paradise outside the coffin. So this is the kind of consideration that encourages you and gives you real hope and gives you real confidence and real assurance, and you know, you just dismiss these storms, you know. So you know, what can this storm do to truth? What can this storm do to my salvation? Nothing. Can what's projected on a screen affect what's behind the screen? What's behind the screen? Can it project it? If there's a movie screen, you're projecting a movie on it, and let's say you're projecting like a disaster movie, and you see this whole ocean comes in and covers a continent and wipes everything out. Is that tsunami that comes in wiping everything out, is that affecting anything behind the screen? Not at all. It's totally flat. It's having zero effect on what's behind the screen. So don't be intimidated by anything that's happening in this world, because it's not affecting what's behind the screen. That movie behind the screen, the second screen, as it were, where that movie of unconditional love is being screened, is not being affected by what's on the screen in front of it at all. No effect. So it's irrelevant what's being projected on the screen in front of it, you know? Don't worry about it. Don't get wrapped up in it. You know, just do what you need to do practically. If the electricity's out, light a candle. Or turn on a flashlight. Or go to bed. Or meditate. Or contemplate. Or, you know? Or open your cell phone or whatever. Might not want to do that because you don't want to run the signal down, the battery down, and you don't want to run the battery down and then you don't have electricity, you can't recharge it. Okay, so you might not want to do that. Might want to turn your phone off to save the battery. You know, if you're freezing real bad, you know, and you've got you might have a car, you can turn it on, turn the heater on. You know, if there's no electricity, you can always turn the heater on for a while and warm up. You know, you can do practical stuff. Sure. Why not? Why not? It doesn't affect what's behind the movie at all, the screen at all. It doesn't affect it one way or the other. Whatever you do doesn't affect it. So you can do practical things. Do whatever seems right to do. And what it doesn't affect what's behind the movie behind this screen doesn't affect it. The screen behind this screen is still screening the movie of unconditional love and nothing being threatened and paradise. You know, it's still screening that. And so whenever you want to move this other screen aside, you can. It's there to be seen. It's there to be seen. There to be experienced. And so, you know, in the meantime, take care of yourself and continue your inquiry, your consideration, your satsang, your contemplation, your meditation, your right use of time, your insight. And just keep up with that, you know. The conditions in the world are always changing. Pretty soon there's going to be an election, right? Pretty soon your Congress is back in session. That's going to be a dog and pony show for sure. I mean, you haven't seen anything yet. What's going to take place now going forward? You know, you know, the movie's about to get into this phase, you know. Stuff happens in movies, right? stuff's always happening in movies. There's always the chase and the car crash and this and this and that, you know. And so we're in that part of the movie where the action takes place. The action scenes are coming now. And of course, but behind this movie screen is another screen where there's a movie you really want to see, where peace and tranquility and unconditional love and inclusiveness and isness and no threat and no vulnerability, that's being screened. And you can check that movie out anytime, any moment. Everybody can. It's there for everybody. Anyone, anywhere, no matter what is on the screen of belief, they can wheel aside and check out the movie on the screen behind it. Always. Wow. Okay. That's enough. All right, that's very great. That's enough for this video. And we are going to end it right now.